Now we go on to discuss how the effect of a diagnosis of cancer is portrayed in cinema. We will feature a very small video clip from the movie My Sister's Keeper. It is also a book. Over to you, Prasad.
Most babies are accidents. Not me. I was engineered, born to save my sister's life.
Having a child who is sick is a full-time occupation. Sure, we still enjoy the usual day-to-day happinesses of family life. Big house, great kids.
You want to see a routine?
Oh, what routine? No.
Hey, baby, what's your sign?
Cancer.
You're a Cancer?
No, I'm a Leo.
But I have cancer.
But beneath the exterior, there are cracks, resentments that threaten the very foundation of our lives.
Oh my gosh, it's really you.
I'm Campbell Alexander.
What can I do for you?
You've seen my commercials.
That's why I'm here.
My sister has been in renal failure for months now.
You're supposed to give her a kidney?
I want to see my parents for the rights to my own body.
Would you repeat that, please?
What's going on?
Anna, you're suing us?
I don't want to do it anymore, Mom. It's my body. I want to be able to make my own decisions about what to do with it.
From the moment we decided to genetically conceive, I suppose it was our fault.
But it's against her will, so how does that work?
We went against nature, but we forced her into helping her sister.
I'm Taylor. Maybe we could hang together sometime.
Yeah.
I don't mind my disease killing me, but it's killing my family, too.
What is she doing out of the hospital?
We're going to the beach.
You take her to the beach, you're killing
her.
She's
going to
die.
You better come, because if you don't, I want a divorce.
But somehow...
Ryan!
The very things that tore us apart.
Anna doesn't want to do it anymore.
I don't believe you.
You are hiding something, Anna.
Just tell him.
Would bring us together in ways we could have never imagined.
Life is beautiful.
I look pretty, Daddy.
But it's cold. I'm gonna let her die.
I can't.
You know, it's important for you to feel like you never gave up.
Sooner or later, you gotta let go.
I know I'll be okay. I'm
sorry I let them hurt you.
You know how brave you are.
That was a short clip about the movie My Sister's Keeper. To discuss this movie and the book, joining with us at Humanitas Programme today is our very own Professor Dinithi Fernando from the Department of Physiology. Welcome, Madam, to the Humanitas Programme.
Hello.
Hello, Madam. Thank you very much. You know, when I asked Professor Dinithi, has she seen this movie? She said, not only have I seen the movie, I have read the book, My Sister's Keeper. Can I ask you, Madam, can you give a small briefing about the book, if you may, and how you feel that the effect of cancer on a family in this extreme example, of course, is portrayed in this book and in this movie, and what can we learn?
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, to give a very short summary of the plot of this book. So, Sarah is the mother. Sarah Fitzgerald is the mother of this family, and she's a lawyer. And Brian is the father, and they have three children. Kate is the middle child. And Jesse is the eldest boy in the family. And Kate is diagnosed with a very aggressive form of leukemia. And then Sarah decides to have a genetically planned, a genetically engineered child, what's called a savior sibling, to take bone marrow for a bone marrow transplant for the sick elder daughter. So, with that diagnosis of Kate's leukemia, the book tells how the whole family is affected by the diagnosis, not only by the diagnosis, but by the decision by Sarah, mother, to have this second child, the daughter, as a savior sibling, and the conflict the whole family go through. So it deals with a lot of complex emotions, such as feeling of neglect by the other children, and also the determination, the anger, the resentment, and also like the bravery and courage of the mother who is fighting for the child who is going to die otherwise. And also like also Anna, who is the protagonist of this book, she's the one who is born as a savior sibling to save her sister. So Anna's complex emotions, like her guilt, on one hand, she wants to help her sister live, but on the other hand, she feels that she's being used by the family, and she does not have any freedom of her own. And the father, who becomes becomes a very although he's a very compassionate person, a gentle person, he also becomes very harassed, and he gets in the middle of this situation, and he does not know whom to support, whether he should support his wife or whether he should listen to Anna, who is the youngest daughter, who is now is getting very upset about the fact that she's being used for her sister's treatment. And then Anna decides to actually sue the family for using her as a savior sibling. And so the story goes on. As Santhushya asked now, at the very beginning of this program, you said that we see the patient, but the doctors, they don't see the family. And this book gives a very good idea of how a family deals with very complex emotions when the diagnosis of such a deadly disease is thrown at them. What I feel is, now it's an American book, and the setting and the culture is very different to us in Sri Lanka. So sometimes it could be difficult for us to relate to the happenings in this book, because according to our culture, the way we live, how we respond to such a diagnosis, such a calamity, will might be very, very different to people who are living in a country like US. Still, the core emotions that the book displays and discusses, I think, is a great eye-opener. I think I would recommend it to all the medical students as a primer to know the emotions, to study the emotions of a family who is dealing with this dreaded diagnosis.
Thank you, madam, for your very succinct and eloquent summary of this book and this movie. Nilufa, can I come back to you after having seen this short movie clip? Can you share with us what was the effect of the diagnosis of Nashad's cancer with your family? Did you also feel partial towards him? Did you have a conflict as a mother? I think that is probably a universal feeling across cultures. Can you tell us something about what happened and how did you react? And did you feel that you had to make him happy, that he's on a deadline, things like that?
Definitely. So now it's two children becomes one child story, because everything now we are doing for him. So food wise, his toys, whatever he wants, we buy, because we now know that he's going through a severe situation than any normal child, especially compared to my younger son. We like, he was very small that time, but there was certain things when we buy, we have to make a decision for whom to buy this. So it's always with priority given to Nashad. But it affected very badly to my second son, because I was away from him for on and off with the treatment. So when he became like, when it started schooling, there was a lot of issues from teachers. Yeah, please give attention to this child. This was one of your children, so please take care of him. So then only we also like felt we need to give more attention to it. But you know, with the situation, the chemos, radiation, so we have to come and on and off. We were coming and going from hospital. So after this entire thing was over, like my son passed away 2020 March. 2020, by not even 6 months, this child got seizure, right? So then we took him to the doctors and did MRIs, everything. So for us, it's another scare now. But still, doctor said because of his chemical issue in the brain, that's why he got this, and he will get it again and again. You have to treat him. So what we understood is the uncertainty he lived through his life until age of 15, because we had a small gap, 1 year gap between them. So until age of 15, he lived in uncertainty world. Because in the morning when he goes to school, I'm at home. But when he comes home, I'm not there. So that's, and when we go to see the biopsy report, it's another uncertainty. We never know how many blast cells have been increased, and we have to end up in hospital. So every 3 months, when you go to see the biopsy report itself, agony for me. I pray, I do everything and go to take that pink color paper. Is really a bad experience. Bad, I think quality of life was really bad for us when it comes to these things. But I'm sure he also, my son also went, he couldn't have a normal life. But though he wanted to do scouting, he says, Mama, I want to do scouting. I said, no, you can't do scouting. No, you don't know when I'm going to die. No one can tell that. You send me scouting. If you want, you also come with me. So every camp I have to take annual leave and I go with him. So I want to play basketball. I said, no, he want to play rugby. I said, no, never. And then put me to basketball because that's the family, the father and the son, all are playing. So he played that. So Malla is really emotional. Last week he had a match. He was wearing Aya's skinny and it was small also, but he was managed to wear it. So I feel a lot of things we went through as a family. So it's not easy. Then I always make my mind. It did only happen to me. I was in the hospital in and out for 10 years. I saw many families. Some children, some didn't have children. The only child they had to send them off. So I made my mind.
And Nilufa, can I ask you? You mentioned that when the cancer diagnosis was made for Nashad, 3 months at a stretch, you were asked to stay in the hospital. And sometimes up to 8 months, you narrated to me personally that you had stayed in the Maharagama Peksha Hospital. Why was it so necessary? Was there some concern for you that you would not want to leave Nashad with anyone, even for a day? Why was that so necessary for you to do that? Apart from the emotional part of it, was there some problem?
Yes, that there was, because there was a problem for me. I wanted to make sure that, you know, these things are given in cannulas. The cannulas go out. So it's another problem after that. And there are instances where they, by mistake, nurses give the wrong pre-hydration and post-hydration, which is a very, very important thing, which is sometimes they miss it. So at one time, we had to do an entire cycle again because there was a mistake in the treatment. So the senior doctor said, no, because we need to give it again. We need to start from, it was called R1, R2, R3. We want to do again one session. So sometimes 8 months I didn't leave. Even my husband was not confident to take over because of these issues. Because sometimes these things can happen. So because I knew, I read, I go through the file. It's not the right thing to do, but I do it. But I know some some mothers don't do, some mistakes could happen. So I wanted it not to happen to my child. So that was one reason I hang up. Like me, there are other mothers also, not only me, but we all hang there because of that issue.
Thank
also.
You for sharing those experiences with us. With this, we go to the next segment of the Humanitas Programme.